All right, now we're officially recording. You're tuned into Local Motion on 91.3 WVKR, independent radio, Poughkeepsie, New York. And if you would please consider subscribing to the YouTube channel, Local Motion on 91.3, as well as the Facebook page by the same name. Greatly appreciated. Thrilled to welcome today. Let's get him on the phone. Nels?
Yeah.
Oh, hi. We're here together. Wonderful. All right.
Oh.
Yes.
I'm probably getting some sort of lag, so all of a sudden you emerged out of yourself.
There I am. There's probably a 7-second delay on it, but now we're like live and everything, so we're good.
Marvelous.
Wonderful. Let me do a brief intro, if I may, before we begin our conversation. I'll start off by saying Rolling Stone has anointed him as one of the 20 new guitar gods and one of the top 100 guitarists of all time. Best known for being the lead guitarist of Wilco, Nels Cline's career spans over numerous decades in jazz, rock, punk, and experimental. He's been on over 200 recordings, including 30 as a leader. Nels also performs in a duo project with Julian Lage. In addition, he performs with the Nels Cline Four in his duo Cup, the Nels Cline Singers, and Stretch Woven, and recently the Concentric Quartet. He'll be performing as part of Creative Music Studios, The Celebration, along with John Medeski, Billy Martin, and countless musicians at Bearsville Theater on August 6th. We'll be giving away a pair of tickets to that show after this conversation. And with that, a warm welcome to Local Motion, Mr. Nels Cline.
Hey, thank you, Rita. Thank you so much. Wow, that made me sound so busy.
Well, you are kind of busy, aren't you?
I guess.
Yeah. But. And by the way, I didn't tell you off when we were off air. I saw John Medeski the other night, and he was telling me all kinds of wonderful things that he just thinks you're fantastic.
Oh, well, what a sweetheart he is. And kind of a badass,
yeah.
If I'm allowed to say that.
Oh, yeah, you are. Yeah, he's a badass all the way around. That guy is a master at his craft. Whenever I can go see him, I go see John Medeski. He's just the best.
And then there's that Billy Martin guy.
He's
also a badass.
Yeah, you guys. Yeah, with the creative music, but you guys with MMW, you also did some work with them.
I did. I basically just improvised with them. The first time they invited me to improvise with them on a week they had at the Blue Note in Manhattan, which was, as I think I described it at the time, to them, it was kind of like landing on my home planet, you know. I just kind of knew what to do. It was so friendly, but also so inspiring. So there was that, and then we made this record in Saugerties at Applehead with a small audience in the studio, because the studio's so big, we could actually fit people in it. And then we toured on some of that improvised music in Europe, whatever year that was.
Right.
I don't know. It's been a while.
Yeah.
But I've been able to play with Billy and with John since then, sort of sporadically. And
yeah.
I always look forward to it.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Terrific guys. And we'll talk more about the Woodstock thing. I'd like to always step back in time. I always say, I love how you start some of your posts. You're like, people of Earth. I always start off my show with this is your life, Nels Cline. So I say that you grew up in L.A., so you're from the L.A. area, yeah?
Totally, yep. My father is from Los Angeles.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And you have a twin brother, Alex, who's also a musician. He's a drummer.
Yeah, he's a badass also.
Yeah.
Yeah, and many records under his own name that are worth checking out, people. Alex Cline, C-L-I-N-E, like Patsy.
Are you related?
No,
oh.
I wish.
Oh, well.
Wouldn't that be something?
Yeah.
You know, I don't even know the story of when Cline got misspelled. There was something that happened. It had to have been K-L-E-I-N somewhere back there, but I don't know anything about it.
Hmm. Interesting. Yeah, that happens over generations, and then all of a sudden you're like, hey, how did we wind up with C-L-I-N-E? So, yeah.
Yeah.
Now,
yeah.
Your dad from... Go ahead.
It stinks to me of trying to pass as Gentile, but I don't really know the story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that would be like what I would have done.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Misspelled. But then again, they misspelled my grandfather's name, whom I'm named after. His name was Niels Nielsen, and they changed it to Nels Nelson when he became when he came to the United States in what I think must have been the early part of the 20th century.
And where was he from?
Denmark.
Ah, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah. So when I go to Scandinavia, everyone wonders what happened to my name, why it's misspelled.
Right, right. They probably urge you to go back to the old way.
Yeah, well, I don't know. It just seems weird. It's
right.
Like supposed to be pronounced Niels, and all of a sudden it's become Nels, which isn't a name there.
So from what I understand, as far as when music first grabbed you and you first started noticing it, was pretty young. Your dad liked Broadway musicals and had a little record collection.
Yeah.
Talk to me about that time, if you would, please.
Oh, man. Well, I grew up with my twin brother in West Los Angeles in this kind of non-vibey neighborhood. It was just a neighborhood, not fancy, not unfancy. And West Los Angeles then was kind of a new community, which is rather odd to think about now. It's not really wants to be near the ocean. But it wasn't that far from the ocean. So we had pretty decent, winds off the ocean. So that was ocean breezes. And my parents were school teachers in the Los Angeles City school system who had met later in life and got married. And my mom had us when she was 40 years old.
Wow.
Which in 1956 was considered like a death sentence for most people.
Yeah.
And also she didn't know she was having twins. So that was bizarre thing. But anyway, already too long of a story shorter. My parents really were kind of like other people I met later in life who were parents of other associates of mine, who were kind of these multifaceted individuals, multi-talented. And my parents could free draw pretty much anything. They were English and history teachers, so they understood the English language to an extreme degree, which I kind of inherited from them, a certain language fascism that I try to resist.
Mm-hmm.
And then, an awareness of culture that they vaunted. They thought that artists were the coolest. And so my brother and I lucked out in that regard. And I think that we got a lot of, as long as we kept our grades up, a lot of latitude, because we seemed to be like artistic types.
Mm-hmm.
And my dad had these, a lot of records, some of which were Broadway musicals, and were his favorites, because Broadway musicals are very important to him. Especially like whatever was happening at the time. Like I remember the 70s, like, oh yeah, No No Nanette was really big in the house for a while. And, everything before microphones on Broadway, no microphones.
Mm-hmm.
And then he had big band records, swing era stuff, like these Time Life compilations. Some of them are the original tracks, some of them might not be, so you hear all those, like, Dorsey's and the Gene Krupa and Benny Goodman and all that stuff. And then he loved Ella Fitzgerald, so mm-hmm. And every once in a while these other records leaked through, and my first memory of a record that somehow like spoke to me, and I think it's because it was programmatic and I could quote-unquote hear the donkeys going down through the Grand Canyon.
Mm-hmm.
It was the Grand Canyon Suite by Groffet, I believe it is.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very programmatic, I suppose. I haven't listened to it, actually, since what year, the early 60s this might have been. But that was probably, in my weird memory, that's my first inkling of, music is interesting.
Wow.
But that really intensified maybe a year or two later with the advent of our awareness of rock and roll music.
Yes.
And that was something that came about more from being kind of wannabe juvenile delinquents and hanging out with these guys that would smoke cigarettes unsupervised in their apartment and listen to the Byrds album Turn, Turn, Turn over and over again. And our friend Pat Pyle, a great drummer in elementary school already, and his sort of mutual fascination along with my twin brother Alex with the Rolling Stones.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Rolling Stones and the Byrds were kind of our identity at ages 10 and 11, I think.
Wow. Wow, that's really cool. I understand that in fifth grade you were studying India, the country, and that you...
That's true. That was my next my next tale to tell. But that became my first awareness of, I think, not only just how much I love Indian classical music right away, but the idea that music is more than entertainment, you know, that it's maybe some other kind of calling,
right,
that is more possibly, you know, what word do you want to use? Cosmic, or it's all on a different level. And so that was big. It was big. Hearing Ravi Shankar in my fifth grade class, Ms. Godlin, she was amazing. She changed my life.
I bet, because I'm guessing many fifth graders just rolled their eyes at that. Is that correct? Or
they hated it.
Yeah.
Oh my God, they were literally making noises like ew. And she played. Ms. Godlin played the entire first side of one of the live World Pacific records, and so that was a good 15, 16 minutes at least,
wow,
possibly 20. You know that they had to sit through this.
Right.
And I became absolutely obsessed and thought of taking up sitar, actually, at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And Ravi Shankar did have a school, an Indian music school in Los Angeles, that closed in 1966, the year that I became aware of him, I guess.
Oh, bum. Yeah.
Yeah, but spared me because, you know, I asked my parents for my music, my life, his sort of first autobiography that's kind of a large format, paperback, very light compared to the tome that came out late in his life. And I read about his initial practice regimen and spending a year, I think, just holding the instrument, learning how to hold the instrument.
Uh-huh.
I said, this is not for me.
Right. Talk about patience.
I don't have what it takes to do this, and I don't even know where to get a sitar. You know what I mean?
Right. So,
1967.
This is when you were about 12 years old. That's when you picked up the guitar, right? You started guitar, and Alex started drums.
I would say I didn't pick up guitar seriously because I think in a way I've spent my life sort of engaging in what they later called magical thinking.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow you would have a great idea, and the idea itself is so incredibly pure and powerful that you'll end up creating something that honors it even slightly, and that will be a marvelous thing.
Right.
So there's never been, I never like learned every Beatles song or played in bar bands or, you know, went through and learned every song in the so-called American songbook. I just sort of wanted to make stuff up.
Yeah.
Mostly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, did you start on the acoustic or the electric?
It was electric. My dad, he taught at a junior high school in West Los Angeles called Emerson Junior High School. And he bought a guitar from a student for about $30 or something, I remember hearing, as a one pickup melody, sort of half scale. Still have it.
Love it.
And so I started with that, and then my amplifier, you know, used to have these things called green stamps and blue chip stamps. And you would get these at the grocery store, and you'd save them up and glue them into a book. And if you had enough books, you for a certain item in their catalog, you could go, what would the word be? It's not retrieve. But anyway, you would go pick up whatever you wanted if you had all the right stamps glued in the right books or whatever. So my first amp was from Blue Chip Stamps. It was also a melody amp, coincidentally, a tiny combo amp, maybe with an 8-inch speaker and maybe 1 watt of power. I have no idea. I eventually blew it up. And
Did you take lessons?
I tried. I really tried. Before we went, as a family, it was a very crucial event. We went to Europe in the early, I guess it would have been late winter, early spring of 1968. And right before that, I had a teacher named Mr. Harvey at Roscoe Music in Culver City. And he was teaching me to play Jingle Bells, as I recall.
Oh, my God.
And Penetration, the surf song.
Uh-huh.
And that, I think I took two lessons from him before we left. And when I came back, he wasn't there, or the store had changed hands or something. We came back 6 months later. Roscoe Music, I just don't think I ever went back there. But then I tried to take lessons in high school at age 17 or so from a multi-instrumentalist teacher at West LA Music, the local, well, one of the local music stores. And that was not a good thing. That didn't work out.
No, that didn't work out too well. I love the name of your, I think, maybe first band in junior high, Toe Queen Love.
Oh, Toe Queen Love. That wasn't the first band, but yeah, Toe Queen Love, that's taken from the inside of a Fugs record called It Crawled Into My Hand Honest. Do you know this record?
I don't, but I know the Fugs. I'll have to check that out.
Well, it's a great, great record. It was their major label debut on Warner Brothers, and it's got production values, and it's absolutely brilliant and insane.
Wow.
But anyway, on the inside cover, it has this little area that says scarf up these forthcoming Fugs LPs, and there's four fake upcoming Fugs records with album covers and description, I think actual song titles, and one of them is called Toe Queen Love. But our first band was Homogenized Goo. That was elementary school. We played at our elementary school graduation.
What did you play? Like rock songs of the time?
No, of course not. We played three originals, you know.
I love it.
With my brother on drums. It was kind of more important what we were wearing in a way, I suppose.
Uh-huh.
But anyway, yeah, three originals. This is when I played guitar with my thumb and only on the B and I E string of the guitar, up and down on the dots, basically. I didn't know a single chord. Anyway,
how impressive, though. Talk to me about composing. I mean, junior high and elementary school. I mean, composing music.
No, I mean, we didn't think of it as composing. I mean, you know, the thing was that if you look at the zeitgeist,
mm-hmm.
it's the late 60s. It's like the air, I'm entering puberty, for God's sake. The air is electric, you know, like
right.
Everything is creativity. And that's what everybody is doing. It's the whole vibe is like, what's your voice? What's your idea?
Yeah.
It's, you know, go for it. I'm trying to find tracks that are as long as possible, and it's not difficult.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right, right. Well,
like
Summer of Love, right? You had Jefferson Airplane, The Grateful Dead, you know, The Holding Company. You had all that stuff out there.
Well, we loved all of it. We were following it very assiduously, and not just the hippie thing, but mostly, you know, we really liked psychedelic sound, and that was very important to altering my consciousness for the rest of my life, frankly. You
mm-hmm.
know, it's like I became psychedelicized even though I hadn't even done drugs yet.
What about jazz? When did that come in? Like, when did you start listening to jazz in a serious way?
Jazz all started for me, and probably for Alex too, on the same afternoon sitting in our friend's apartment. I still don't know why he wasn't there or his dad. Nobody was there but us. But this, I mean, in a way it wasn't unusual for like how we'd hang out with some of these apartment dwellers in our neighborhood. There was a lot of unsupervised activity going on. But anyway, so we're listening on his little stereo to a copy of John Coltrane, His Greatest Years, Volume 1, which... Mm. Our friend David Hirschman, marvelous, marvelous person, friend from back then, had been asked by his dad, Jack Hirschman, who became very influential in a way on me. He's a kind of an intense poet. I think if you search Jack Hirschman, he'll come up right away. Anyway, Jack had asked his son David for a copy of this record for a birthday present, because it's like, Dad, what do you want for your birthday? And when our friend David heard it, he thought that Alex might like it because, quote, it reminded him of some of the instrumental Frank Zappa stuff you like, end quote. Something like that. I'm paraphrasing, of course. It's only been like 55 years.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
Well, not quite. But then the first track on this record is Africa, an edited version of Africa. And that was it. That was it. I had no idea that we were going to hear anything like that and I didn't have any precedent for the sound of that piece with the Eric Dolphy arrangement and Coltrane's virtually vibratoless tenor, that sort of incredible, man, that serious vibe.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was it. I just thought, what is going on here? And Alex and I were like, we got to figure this out. Like, what's been going on? So we basically jumped off into, my brother got into Tony Williams' Lifetime. So from there on, it was just Don McLaughlin, obviously Miles. What is this Miles guy? And you go pretty much any direction for Miles, and you get everything.
Right.
So we were off. Yeah. We were off on quite a voyage.
Wow, that is quite
also
a voyage.
At the same time, we're listening to progressive rock, so-called,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
which was kind of like what I started listening to after I got sort of, I don't know what, disillusioned with, tired of, too mm-hmm. sad to listen to blues rock that I'd been listening to mostly.
And, mm-hmm.
After Duane Allman died, I was kind of inconsolable.
I was going to mention him because I know that he was a big influence for you, correct?
Yeah, Duane. There were certain people that had a certain voice on the guitar that I felt was something that I wanted to emulate at that time.
Mm-hmm.
And my reason for playing guitar was Jimi Hendrix. Mm-hmm. But there was not a moment in my mind that I ever thought I would do anything that sounded like Jimi Hendrix. It was not a goal.
Mm-hmm.
Jimi Hendrix was just like pure electricity, pure inspiration. And I just thought he was untouchable. You know, I hate to use all these sort of like boomer hippie terms that people toss around cavalierly, but it did have, I think, what I guess a shamanistic kind of like hold on my imagination and feelings.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't know that term then. Anyway, so I thought of people like Duane, particularly because the Allman Brothers Band, just their music was so inspiring. So he and Dickie together, so important. But also there was that sort of, I think I've overused this word, modesty, but I was looking for a more modest approach that was melodic and bluesy. And when I heard the Allman Brothers Band's first record, it was played before it came out on KPPC, the underground FM station that Alex and I tuned into nightly.
Nice.
I lost my mind when I heard this.
Mm-hmm.
And then I became very fixated on Duane and also several other guitarists from that era, most of whom nobody talks about, and I'm not trying to be an obscurant. One of them everybody talked about for a long time was Peter Frampton. But Peter Frampton, when he was in Humble Pie,
yes.
Beautiful melodic style, was very important to me. And every time I mention him in interviews, that seems to get somehow magically left out, like somehow they're trying to save me.
Really?
For myself.
Oh, gosh.
Like, don't mention Peter Frampton.
Oh, no, no, no. He's amazing.
Well, anyway,
no.
He became very important, along with this guy, Peter Banks, who is the first guitarist in the band, Yes, who I think gets, you know, he had a melodic style that was very akin to where I felt I was trying to go at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's Steve Howe, who's obviously like a guitar god. But he was kind of doing so much that still had this kind of, he actually still had this kind of like rootsy feel, kind of almost funky feel at times for somebody who was like obviously so classical. He's trying to be all classical and magical and prim, like a lot of these elfin prog rock gentlemen and wearing their frocks and finery, you know. But Steve Howe is just ripping, you know, he's just like ripping. Jan Ackerman also is very important around this time. He was in this band Focus,
mm-hmm.
and had this really severe kind of asshole-ish style, if I'm allowed to say that on the air. Nasty.
Yeah.
Nasty and crazy and really searing, and but also kind of like still kind of a rock player.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So these guys were the guys I was kind of expanding out from, and then obviously hearing Don McLaughlin and Sonny Chirac and people, the handful of guitarists that were kind of wailing in the early 70s primarily, I guess. This one I heard Ralph Towner, who became so incredibly important.
When did you get your first upgraded guitar from the one that you had originally just told us about?
Oh, I'll have to condense this story. Because there were three before I had a decent guitar.
Oh.
And so the second one was a Japanese guitar made by a company. I've never seen another one since, called Penn, P-E-N-N.
Do you still have it?
No, I ended up kind of just letting a ne'er-do-well aspiring friend of ours hang on to, along with the amp that my dad and I built, a Heathkit amp we built together one summer.
Oh, nice. And
that I wish I still had. But anyway, if Peter Vassilopoulos is listening to this, dude, I'd really love to have that Heathkit amp back. But anyway, and then after that was a Univox Les Paul custom copy used. There was no vintage market back then. This is 1970-71.
Right.
So, and then my dad inherited some money from his cousin who unexpectedly died and left him some money. And he said, okay, you're obviously serious. Let's try to get you guys some real equipment.
Oh, so
I got my 1971 Gibson ES-335.
Wow.
That I still own, and that is on the Wilco song Either Way.
Really? Isn't
that the first track on Sky Blue Sky? That's my first good guitar. It's also on a song on that record that I don't think we've ever played live, called Leave Me Like You Found Me.
Mm-hmm.
If I'm saying it even right at this point, because it's been so far out of our minds, but it's a song I really like.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Very gentle, and the guitar is on that as well.
Wow.
And that was it. 1971.
Brand new guitar. Brand new, you got it. And now it is a vintage guitar 50 years later.
Yeah. So, yeah. Like its owner.
Yeah. Well, some things get better with age, Nels, and you're definitely one of them. So I wouldn't worry about the aging thing. If you would please talk to me about coming to New York. And now you're obviously a New Yorker.
That was so much later. And so I'll also probably in a great futility try to condense the story. But I first came to New York City with my family in 1967. We drove across country and back, and we had a friend living at that time, I believe, in the upper 80s, and I can't remember if it was west or east, in an apartment. And so we stayed with him and then drove back across the country. And then again in 1968, when we came back from the UK, having been in the UK and Europe for 5 months, and then spent some time in New York. During this time, in 67, I got a chance, Alex and I both, to see the Birds play in Central Park.
Oh, nice.
And that was our first big concert.
Uh-huh.
And then we flew out the day that the double bill was the Jimi Hendrix Experience and the Young Rascals. And so that was a tragic day. But anyway.
That it was, yeah.
Because I never got to see Jimmy. But but anyway, so New York kind of had a place in my consciousness. But I think crucially also, it had a really big place in my parents' consciousness, particularly my father. And with his Broadway fixation and with our friend Larry in town and just the... I think everything about it, the energy of it, was what my dad kind of aspired to being around more often.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know, I never had a chance to actually ask him, like, what's your deal with New York? Like, but, my parents were, my mom, in her late 80s went blind. The only magazine subscription that she couldn't cancel was the New Yorker.
Mm.
She just couldn't do it, even though she couldn't read it.
Wow.
And, yeah, so there was a bit of a New York thing going on.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, as somebody interested in improvised music and later, and what I believe maybe historically you could say came out of, it was part of punk rock, but then came out of also the so-called no wave scene. A lot of music that I really cared about and became fascinated by, having gotten back into so-called punk rock, the Minutemen were really important for that, mm-hmm. coming out of San Pedro. But the New York scene fascinated me, as it did. We went in the 70s, Alex and I went on a jazz pilgrimage there, and that's when I decided, like, okay, this place is like a foreign country, and it's kind of terrifying that the city in the 70s was obviously, at that time, bankrupt, and
yeah.
It was wild. Yeah. It was definitely a heavy scene, but I loved it. I don't know. I think that was about the music. Like, I would have done anything to be around more improvisers, mm-hmm. And furthering that music that was so inspiring to us, that had a lot to do with the loft scene at that time there, and also with, you know, we went to go see these concerts, like tribute to John Coltrane as part of Newport in New York, and we went to go hear the Herbie Hancock retrospective.
Oh, nice.
Which was super exciting for us because we were in love with what's now called the Mwandishi Band, and they reunited for this, and they played so beautifully. It was so inspiring. But anyway, so New York. So it became this big New York thing, but then I didn't move there. So personal life intervened.
Yeah.
I got married in 1981, some gnarly stuff went down. My wife got an injury. We had just basically, I wasn't going to take her to New York while I was like trying to quote unquote make it.
Right.
I was never going to do that to her.
Right.
And I was terrified that I'd fail anyway, and I probably would have, honestly. But anyway.
Really?
I finally moved there because I met my wife, Yuka, making a record that Mike Watt had put together called Forward by Four. In 2009, July of 2009, and having been a fan of Cheap Omato, it was a little bit unobvious that we would somehow in any way connect beyond making this record, but we did, and it was miraculous, and that's when I decided I could finally move to New York.
So you're pretty recent. You've only been here about 13 years.
That's right.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Wow. Oh.
Yeah, after wanting to move in 1976. So it took me a while. It was totally worth the wait, but now we're not there anymore. So now we're among the escapees.
Oh, yes, yes. Well, there are many of you and that have escaped, especially here to the beautiful Hudson Valley, which is obviously...
We're north of you.
Where we're broadcasting from. You are. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. No, yeah. New York State's a beautiful state, though. You know, you're still close to the city. That's what I love about where we are. An hour and a half on the train, boom, there we are. And it's just, it's an amazing city. And it's, I just love this state and this area and the whole northeast of this country. And it's pretty.
I'm with you. Yeah. I'm with you on this 100%. In fact, you know, there are those who would consider a person from Southern California leaving it for the weather that we have up here just west of Oneonta. And I'm sorry, I had too much sun, I had too much heat, and too much, I don't know, too much. So I had to think about this for about 2 seconds before I left. But the point being that I've absolutely endlessly fascinated by New York State, and I sound like this kind of jive, you know, chauvinistic, whatever the word is, New York chauvinism kind of dude, but I love New York State.
Yeah.
I just do. I don't even like this sort of marking territory bullshit, but
right,
seriously,
right.
New York State is really fabulous.
It really is. I mean, you can do anything. You've got the beautiful Adirondacks, you've got the beaches, you've got the Finger Lakes. I mean, it's a really remarkable state. And I'm with you. I love this state. So where does one even continue? I think I need that 2 hour and 20 minute conversation with you that I listened to the other day.
Oh, God.
So
the thing I want to say, the thing I want to point out, though, is that I was never going to be one of these people to leave the city. Okay. Mm-hmm. That was like in my mind. This was like absolutely, like, I was going to die in New York City or Brooklyn or wherever. I was going to, like, that was it.
Right.
Did not realize that, you know, some people got really, really tired of the city after having lived there for almost 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be the case of my wife. But then beyond that, we're pretty adaptable. I'm pretty adaptable. And this shift, after this kind of like almost panicked exodus out of our building with hundreds of people in it. Wow, it's one of the most incredible experiences. I'm very lucky. I feel very lucky. But I also just very lucky to be in what I guess some people would consider maybe not the most hospitable weather, because of the winters or whatever, but man, I'm way into it.
Yeah.
I'm still like the newbie, so it's all beautiful and exotic to me.
It absolutely is. Absolutely.
Right now, it's just so great. Everybody I know is dying right now in the heat.
Right.
And we're just looking at this robust, lush universe.
Yeah.
And it's not that hot.
No, it's not. I mean, you know, we're all spoiled. Come on. Most of us have air conditioning and all of that. And it's just like, I love the four seasons, the beauty of the fall, the colors, the openness of the spring when everything is just popping. It's just, you know, it's a really, really beautiful area in here. So speaking of which, I mean, you obviously travel a whole lot. We do have to talk about Wilco, which you joined 18 years ago. And Wilco just released a new album, if I'm correct, right? Cruel Country?
You are.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
It's digitally released. The double vinyl is going to be a little while.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure when. It's you know, the wait for such things these days is extremely long.
Yeah. And you are going to start tour soon with Wilco, August 12th, and you're going to be pretty close, I'm guessing, to home, New York State. You'll be at Omegang.
Cooperstown.
Yeah, on August 21st. So any listeners, you check out the Wilco website and check out the amazing tour that's coming up, but they will be in New York State at the Omegang Brewery in Cooperstown on August 21st. But you know what's really cool? Before that happens, you're going to be in Woodstock, and you're going to be at the Bearsville Theater as part of the Creative Music Studio, which is what an amazing place that is. I've had Carl Berger and Ingrid Cerzo on my show, and wow, what they've accomplished over these last 60 years that they've been in the Woodstock, and you know, and Billy Martin now. Yeah, and Billy Martin now taking over as the executive director. So they're doing this first annual festival called the Celebration. And Nels, tell us about it, because you're part of it with Medeski and Martin.
I don't know. I can't remember everything I read. It was a long list of performers, combinations. I don't know what's going to happen. I know that it's going to be some cool stuff. My brother Alex and I, particularly Alex, at that time was in the 70s, was really down with Carl and Carl's stuff. He's been doing incredible music that I think now people don't exactly remember, because he devoted himself to the Creative Music Studio and his teaching all this time, which is kind of a quixotic adventure at best, especially just negotiating creative music and the demand for it in the 80s to now.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of a rough hang. And right. So he's done it. But I do suggest that people go back and listen to, there's a double record from the Creative Music Studio from the 70s that has, you know, Ingrid's on it and a lot of different people. It's got such a beautiful vibe. I think it's a completely overlooked improvised music record. And I think it's just called Creative Music Studio, but it's black and white cover, double album, really cool. And then now I'm trying to, I think, of course, one of my old man mental blocks, trying to remember Carl's record. I think it's called like Tune Up or something. But anyway, it's a beautiful quartet session.
Yeah.
Really, really good.
Yeah.
Check out Carl. And then, yeah, I'll be there jamming.
Yeah, you are going to be there. And it's like a five-hour event. It's like from 7 to midnight at the Bearsville Theater. So, listeners, stay tuned, because I will be giving away a pair of tickets to this event. Not yet. Don't even bother calling, because I'm not going to pick up. So the Celebration is what it is, Creative Music Studio. You'll be there August 6th. And they say it runs from 7 p.m. till midnight. So, yeah.
But we're going to pack a lot of stuff in there, because I've seen a list of people, and I think it's going to be really diverse and amazing. I know that the amazing bass player Ken Filiano, who I've known, I guess, kind of on and off now for a long, long time, he's going to bring it big time. He's going to probably play with a lot of people, I would hope, anyway. So I don't know. Come on down if you like creative music, and we're going to have a really, really big old jam, me and Billy Martin and John Medeski, I suppose, at the end or something when the big rock is supposed to happen.
Yeah, that'll be it. You know what was cool? The first time I met you was the only time I verbally, physically, hello, met you was at Colony in Woodstock when you were there and you did this solo set, and I was just blown away by you.
Oh, God, yes, yes. Joel Harrison.
Yeah,
that was recent.
Yes.
I find playing solo extremely nerve-wracking. It's very difficult to do, but I'm glad you were there. Thank you.
I think that most people in your position that play in front of tens of thousands of people, I'm friends with Byron Isaacs of the Lumineers, who, you know, started with Levon Helm and all of that. And now the Lumineers, like you guys, are packing, you know, stadiums. And it's like he says...
Okay, wait a second. Well, we don't do stadiums.
Well, not stadiums, but you
we play mostly theaters, but they're more than come to improv music gigs, that's for sure.
That's true. But, I mean, like Wilco Solid Sound, your Solid Sound Festival, that's a lot of people. And I don't know. I always think of Wilco as this, like, big, magical, like that, like just a lot of people. Maybe not stadiums, stadium, but...
It's pretty big for me, I'll say that. But I have to also say that I find it weirdly easier to play in front of large crowds.
Yes.
Because, you know,
right.
I don't look at the audience anyway, but there's just, maybe that's just that bit of remove
mm-hmm.
that I need to just relax. I have no idea, but I'm generally not very relaxed. Mm-hmm. So.
Really? You still get nervous before gigs?
Sometimes, yeah, particularly, where there's a lot of, like music reading or a lot of notes, you know, I know I'm going to choke. So I'm not the guy for that. So I get really, really scared, and I make sure to mess up.
Mm-hmm. And you're probably the only one that notices that you've messed up because... No?
I'll never know.
Yes.
Nobody's brave enough to come up and say, like, where were you on bar 52?
Right. What the heck happened to you, Nels? What happened to you?
What was that? What was that?
I'm just going to end up asking, you've played in so many different countries. Is there a country you haven't played at yet there that you would like to go to?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I guess the first one that comes to mind is South Korea.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
But I wouldn't mind playing in... Basically, I haven't spent any time in Southeast Asia, so anywhere... where I can get in and out of there, okay, I'm down with a Southeast Asia booking
mm-hmm.
anytime.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of is what first comes to mind.
Nice.
The other places are just places that I'd like to return to, you know. But I'm sure if I thought about it, I could say, like, oh, yeah, Tierra del Fuego sounds really great. I think maybe if I played in Tierra del Fuego, whatever South American countries it's part of, then that, you know, that might be something like documentary worthy, because it'd just be so harsh.
Right.
I don't know.
Right. Well,
question to answer, actually.
Right. Well, your Wilco tour coming up is going to have you, I think, primarily in the U.S., but also in Canada, right? Canada, North America.
That is correct.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah.
Good old North America.
North America. Yeah. Here they come. Here they come. And I'm going
to
play a track of...
We were supposed to be in Canada when the plug got pulled and the lockdown went locked.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so we're going to go back, I guess, and, you know, do some makeup gigs.
Play some makeup gigs. But how nice that you had Solid Sound this year.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
All of it's good.
Yeah.
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 So, and I'm happy about all of it. I'm so happy to be able to actually play.
For live people, you know, for like...
real people.
Yeah. And Nels, I also really want to say that you have a new album out with the Nels Cline Singers. It's called Share the Wealth, and it was released on Blue Note Records. Right. So
it's not that new, but now I guess it is new. I mean, it's because it came out of probably... Not that it was ever going to sell anyway, but it was just, it came out at probably the worst time for a record to come out, which was the week after the 2020 election.
Ugh.
So everybody's just like, Okay, great.
Right.
Including me.
Oh,
including
gosh.
Me.
But it's
a record I'm really proud of, and it's actually really, I think, I dare say, I rarely toot my own horn, but I think the fact this is a kind of extendo, lots of improvising, electronic-infused, jazz rock kind of record on the beautiful and obviously much respected Blue Note label, mm-hmm. is kind of one of the weirdest and most amazing things ever. But I also think, having said that it does in its own way fit in with the legacy of a lot of Blue Note recordings, perhaps not the ones that make all the album cover compendium coffee table books, but like records like Odyssey of Isca by Wayne Shorter or even Supernova for that matter. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Tony Williams records. There's just all really important factors in what this Share the Wealth record is, which is this weird kind of jazz rock.
Right.
Which is kind of what I was really into in high school. So I guess, what have I developed? Have I changed? I have no clue.
Evolved. Evolved.
I have no idea.
Nels, I suggest people go to your website, NelsCline.com. Of course, Wilco tour coming up. I'm going to do a pair of ticket giveaways momentarily. So what I'm going to do is play this Wilco, the new track that you sent me, The Empty Condor. And
The Empty Condor, yeah. Kind of dark. We haven't been playing it live. I love this track.
Oh, great. Well, that's, you picked it. So everything I'm playing, you have picked. I just want to really thank you for your time here today. It's the most precious gift one can give of themselves. So thank you so much.
Rita, thank you. Thank you so much for giving me so much damn time to be the loquacious gas bag, you know.
Anytime, Nels. Anytime. The door's open for you here anytime, and I could talk hours more with you. I literally can, but I need to get this tickets done, and I want to just really thank you, and I'm going to play another track. Enjoy tour. I hope to see you out there soon, and really thank you for your time, and just keep doing what you're doing. You're a master at your craft. Thank you for giving the world some great music.
See you in Bearsville, everybody. Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
Bearsville.
Safe travels, Nels. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Ciao. All right, folks, we've got a pair of tickets to give away to see Nels Cline along with 23 other artists at Bearsville Theater on Saturday, August 6th. You can call us here now at 845-437-7178. You and a guest will be able to go see this performance. Just give me a call. 845-437-7178. The phone lines are open if you want to win a pair of tickets. This is part of the Creative Music Studio, The Celebration. It's the first annual festival. There are 24 performers, and Nels Cline of Wilco will be one of them. So let us take the phone lines, and let's play a track right now by Wilco. This is brand new off their album, Cruel Country. It's called Empty Condor, and the phone lines are going crazy. Nels Cline with Wilco, 91.3.
Oh, spell. Waiting there, peaches disagreed on it beneath the leaves.
WVKR Wilco, brand new music from their album Cruel Country, and we just heard The Empty Condor. So Nels Cline's today's guest, if you missed part of that interview or any of it, or you want to hear it again,